Hey everybody, welcome back to
Income School. Today we're looking at 10 of your
brand new websites. Not necessarily brand new, all of them do have content on the site, but none of them have significant traffic yet. So the concept is this: Nate, who's running the camera today, is going to set the clock for 2 minutes, and we're gonna do a quick review, just punching on the most important things that you guys need to make sure you're doing on your new site. Let's get started. All right, the first site is called animalknowhow.com. The site has 6,000 page views a month, but it has 83 posts, and so it's underperforming a little bit where we would like to see with that many posts, given the average age of those posts is now 7 months old. But they've also proven a lot of the concept. And as I look at the website, I can see why some things have gone really well. I can see that they're writing about questions that people would Google and trying to provide a helpful resource. That seems like a small thing, but it's actually a big deal that a lot of people miss. They're writing just interest stuff, and this person understands questions. But let's look at two specific examples of where they can improve. The first one is this: do pet rats get sick easily? So if that's our primary search that we're targeting is, do pet rats get sick easily? Now look at the rest of the title: 12 common ailments and prevention. We're really writing three different articles here. Do pet rats get sick easily? What are common ailments? And how to prevent rats from getting sick. Now I like providing a complete resource, but when I Google this, when I just type, do pet rats get sick easily, everything is about identifying those sicknesses, and there are some great resources here that stay on one topic, and so I'm concerned about that post. Then we look at the next one, how to keep a pet rat from smelling, and here the answer target is basically just a comma-separated list of a bunch of different tips. That's not going to work to win the answer target. So those two things, and really going through making sure the articles are right, is I think what this site needs to do, just cleaning up the content.
All right, this next site is improvescripting.com, great name. This is a website about coding and about scripting, right? Specifically, as I look through the website, it's about PowerShell. This website is doing reasonably well. There are 35 blog posts on the website. Their average age is about 9 months, which means that at this point, they're probably doing about as well traffic-wise as they're probably gonna do long-term. The traffic to the website is just shy of 10,000 page views per month, which means he's averaging almost 300 page views per post per month. Now, we like to see better than that. We like to see our articles, our goal is 1,000 on average. Anywhere between 500 and 1,000, I'd be pretty happy with. And so we're maybe underperforming there a little bit. And what that means is that you've probably written some posts that just don't have the search volume that you need, or that you're just not winning the ranking for. You're earning $137 from ads, which from an RPM standpoint means about $13 to $14 per 1,000 page views. So your monetization for this is actually not bad here. So I think what we need here is a couple of things. One, scale. 35 blog posts is a good start, but you know, given the age of the site, I'd like to see you doing a bit more here. You talk about the competition that you have. You're often competing with companies like Microsoft for some of the topics for your website. And that can be really hard to do unless you really, really niche down. What I'm finding that you're doing well, which tells me that you're probably getting some data that shows that this is working for you, is how-to blog posts. How-to articles are really, really helpful. They can be hard to write, but they're really, really helpful. And there's something that a lot of the big companies aren't going to do. Find specific topics, specific queries, and then answer those questions in a blog post.
Soccermentality.com. I love the niche. It's a worldwide sport. So I think there are a lot of good things happening. The other thing that I think is good happening here is he's got a YouTube channel. Let's go check it out right now. And I think you two will find something immediately apparent as we watch this YouTube channel that could perhaps be a little bit improved. why isn't he on a soccer field? We're sitting in front of a fireplace, and the camera is, oh, I was gonna have a prop. Don't stop my time. I'll be right back. I'm coming, you guys. Dang it, where is it? There it is. All right. It's fine to make a YouTube channel. I'm still talking, excuse me. It's fine to have a YouTube channel recorded on a cell phone. That's how Income School started. We recorded for months and months just on a cell phone. But you gotta get this. Get a GorillaPod with a cell phone clamp and just set it on the desk. It's gonna look so much better. If you're doing something standing up, get this little clamp on top and then get just a light stand. You can do a tripod too, but a light stand is really lightweight and small. And put this on a light stand and your video is just gonna look so much better. This content with a steady camera standing on a soccer field is great, no problem. Okay, now the blog. As we look at the blog itself, we really need to step up our game in editing. So let's just a cursory look revealed some problems. Which soccer socks protect against blister? We would normally say blisters. How long will my soccer cleats should and will last? Odd wording is how long should my soccer cleats last? It's just strange wording here. And then last, should soccer player and then capital B for bulk. It's just a little awkward how things are written here. I think you need to pass this through an editor to get a second set of eyes on the work.
This next site is nomadboomer.com. This was a site originally intended to be about baby boomers that are retiring and traveling the world, right? And so with COVID-19 hitting and travel just kind of dying, it's really kind of turned toward health advice and tips for baby boomers. Which does kind of put it into a little bit more of a YMYL category. One of the questions that asked by the owner of this website is, can a demographic like baby boomers make a good niche? I do think that there are enough things about this type of demographic, and there are other demographics that would work, where it could make a good niche. But the big issue I see with this website, besides its design, I know everybody like works hard at trying to make their website look the way they want it to look, and you might like the way that yours looks. To me, I don't at all. You're using a perfectly good theme, but just kind of the layout you have, the blog posts, there's just so many things going on here. My eyes aren't drawn to anything at all. And so, yes, we're gonna be relying on Google to send traffic to specific articles, not so much the homepage. But I find that on my blogs, the homepage gets a lot of traffic overall. And so if you can use that homepage as a great place to point people to the best resources on your site, that's a good idea. But back to the bigger issue I think that we have here, is there are a lot of articles that are making a distinction without a difference. So you're writing articles where it's like, why mahi-mahi is helpful for boomers? Well, it's the same reason it's helpful for everyone else, right? And so baby boomers might be Googling like, why should I be eating mahi-mahi? Or should I eat mahi-mahi or whatever? Or is mahi-mahi good for me? So what you're doing is you're competing with people on that broader search, but you've written an article only for baby boomers and it's made you think that your competition is very low. So you're writing articles you'll probably never rank for simply because you're creating a distinction there where no distinction is necessary. So I would do some search analysis and look for topics where there is an actual distinction where something is different or unique to baby boomers.
Stickhandlingpro.com. I love this domain name. So the site appears to be mostly about field hockey, but stick handling is perfect because you can talk about, you know, regular hockey, lacrosse uses a stick. There are a lot of stick-based games. So I love the title of the website. I think it's very well done. So let's talk about field hockey specifically, since I see a lot of content on the website about that. Field hockey is pretty much a New England sport and Australia. We can see that by going to Google Trends, and I'm just typing in field hockey. And then here it's defaulting to the US, and you can see it's mostly New England. And then we can change here to go worldwide, and we see the same thing. That it's mostly the US, a little Canada, a little Australia, but it's mostly a New England kind of game. Then the stickhandlingpro.com, when I go there, I don't see anywhere that I find the blog here. It looks like it's just a landing page for your app. Way down in the footer, there's a link to your blog. There's a ton of content on the blog. Why are we hiding that? It's fine to put everything in blog, but let's have a menu up here to advertise these articles and to show to Google their importance. Now, as I look through the actual content on the site, I actually am seeing really good things. The only thing I might say is when you're dealing with a pretty niche thing like field hockey, you may want to avoid some of the search terms that are fairly small even within that ecosystem because it's a small bucket and now we're taking a piece of it. So I did see a couple instances where maybe the articles were a little too small.
This next website is chooseveganism.com. The average age of the articles, there are 52 of them, the average age of the articles on this site is only 3 months, and yet it's already achieving 7,000 page views. That to me is a good sign. Also, I'm generally very happy with what I'm seeing here on the website. I do think you've picked a fairly competitive topic. There are a lot of bloggers. If you think about kind of the blogger lifestyle and the types of things that bloggers naturally gravitate to, it's like what you eat, it's fitness, it's being a mom, it's, you know, just parenting, I should say. And so this kind of falls into that category. And so there's a fair amount of competition, but you're doing a good job. As I go through the articles on this website, I'm finding that your search analysis is generally very good. As I click into some of these articles, I'm seeing that you're staying very well on point. All of your subheadings are sticking to the main topic at hand. And I think that's part of the reason that you're doing as well as you are. I do think that there is one opportunity that is missed in some of the articles or many of the articles on your website. And here's that opportunity. In this article, is Bourneville vegan? You have this great answer target. I would put the answer target closer to the top, but you have a great answer target. Cadbury Bourneville chocolate is generally suitable for vegans. However, it does contain palm oil, which some vegans choose to avoid due to links with deforestation. And on and on. That is a great answer target. You are staying very on point. You're giving a clear answer right up front. Now we go to this other article. Can you be a part-time vegan? There's kind of an answer target here. It's not bolded. It's not formatted separately so Google can easily find it. And you answer it by, yes, it's entirely possible to follow a vegan diet part of the time. It feels a lot more like, uh-huh, yeah, of course. It feels a little bit less encyclopedic, which is better for answer targets. And you started it with that one word answer. An answer target needs to be very standalone. It needs to be able to be shown, even if the question is phrased in a different way. It needs to be able to be shown as a snippet. Now, one thing that's extremely important is to make sure that you never...
Sorry, dude, you lost your time. I'm going to start saying that I'm a part-time vegan. Like every time I go to Subway and order a salad, I'm like, yeah, I'm vegan. Like now, not later when I go to a steakhouse. Okay, thetennisadvocate.com. This site is a news-based site. And so let's talk. News is a sticky wicket. There were a number of websites that started in the photography space when I did. Some of them took news and they ran with it hard for years. Those that did really succeeded big because photography is a very large industry. A lot of people are interested in new cameras. And so that daily effort of writing news articles over and over and over again did pay off. The more likely scenario, though, is that you write news article after news article and news after news article. Google News doesn't accept you, doesn't start showing your articles very much because you're this itty bitty little website that nobody's ever heard of. And it doesn't look like a professional organization. This doesn't. It doesn't look like a news site yet. But that's what we have here. And so the risk is, and this person has, how many articles do they have? 342 posts. And the risk is you create that content, but it's gone a week from now. It has no value. It's old. It's old news. And so we like, and what we advocate is writing primarily evergreen content. Because if you write 342 just informational posts, they can be getting you traffic 10 years from now on a topic like tennis. And so there's nothing wrong with news. If you're going to do it, you need news schema, you need to write like a news organization, and you need to have your design done like a news website. But just recognize you're running a big risk.
This next site is BeagleCare.com. Now, one of the things that I really think stands out on this site for improvement is something that I think you've already maybe started to figure out. As I look at some of the most recent articles, you're doing a good job of answering specific questions. How high can beagles jump? That's a specific question that somebody would Google. 9 possible reasons why your beagle won't eat. Sorry. That's like a great staple post, but in response to the question, the query, why won't my beagle eat? 7 types of fences for beagle-proofing your yard. Can beagles have blue eyes? These are great. They're tied to a specific query. As I go to your more aged posts and I look at them, it's like, how do I identify a purebred and healthy beagle puppy? Why do beagles sleep so much? I guess some of those are specific. I identified here, kind of in the middle, a whole lot of interest content. 7 commands you need to teach your beagle puppy. How to create, train beagle puppy or dog step-by-step guide. That's a pretty good one. 14 qualities of beagles that will make you want one. That in particular, I found like a bunch of these as I was scrolling through here. You do have 19 pages of blog posts. You've done a good job of creating lots of content. There's a fair amount of interest content here. 14 qualities of beagles that will make you want one is not something that's going to be tied to any reasonable Google search. So I would make sure that you're creating a lot of content that is very tied to specific search. The other thing that you have going for you is you have your Instagram account with 15,000 followers that you've built up pretty quickly. And you just, I mean, in the post they said that they're having a hard time figuring out how to convert that traffic or monetize that traffic. And I mean, just like look at this. There's a reason people are following your Instagram account. That is cute, right? But what we don't have in any of these posts is any sort of call to action. You have interest content on your website. Let's put that interest content in the caption for your Instagram posts and try to get people to interact and come to your site. Right now, there's nothing. The Instagram posts are great and people want to see them, but there's nothing to do once I see that. Put it in the caption. Give me a link. Send me over to the website.
This is a brand new website, dorkycats.com, and they're really working on getting a lot of content out there. To be honest, I don't think the site looks real nice, the design of it. They're using Elegant Themes here, which I think makes a great theme. They produce Divi, and we use Divi a lot to design specific pages. I wouldn't recommend Divi or Elegant Themes really in general. For a brand new site owner, unless you have some real experience with design, they're easy to make look ugly. They can be made to look amazing, but it's easy to mess up. So I probably would go to a more streamlined theme here to get a design that just looks clean and simple. But looking at the actual content of the site, let's look at this. Why does my cat run ahead of me? Hazardous moves? First of all, the title's a little weird, this hazardous moves. I don't understand what that is. A lot of the titles kind of follow that formula. One question and then another kind of weird, I don't know. Then we see a star rating. I don't know why we have a star rating here on a post. It's not a review. But then my biggest concern is follow the subtitles. So somebody came to this wondering why their cat runs ahead of them. The first subtitle, why does my cat run ahead of me when I'm walking? Okay, still a specific time. Why my cat tries to trip me when I walk? Not quite what they Googled. Why does my cat swipe at me when I walk by? Not at all what they Googled. Why does my cat follow me then run away? Not at all. They were asking about ahead of them. Now we're talking about behind. And then we have related questions that are only kind of related. Really, only about 300, 400 words of this post are actually on point. Then this one about the ghost thing, it's a little too niche, I think. Here the question is, washing cat bowls in the sink. Somebody's Googling this about sanitation, and here we're giving tips about it. It's just not quite following the searcher intent.
This next website is hacktheminotaur.com. This is a gaming website. Now, this is an interesting case. The average age of the posts on this website is 3.8 months old. There are 55 of them, but he says he's getting 396,000 page views a month to his website. And he says half of that is direct clicks from YouTube.
Whoa, that's amazing.
Yeah, I suspect that most of the rest of that is either not direct clicks from YouTube, but still kind of referrals from your YouTube channel, and or just the benefit that you're getting by having that massive amount of traffic and that no link mention potentially, or the actual link from YouTube, and Google seeing that. And so potentially your articles are doing better organically in search now as well because of what you've done with that on YouTube. So that's fantastic, but you're earning $400 a month from AdSense. This website has been rejected by AdThrive a couple times. And I think you said even, yeah, and Mediavine as well a couple of times. I don't think that those sites or those companies are really well set up to handle this type of a website. I don't think it's really their bread and butter. I would apply to Ezoic. Ezoic works with, has actually several gaming websites that do really, really well for them in terms of ad revenue. I honestly think that getting approved, if you're approved for AdSense, getting approved for Ezoic shouldn't be hard. And I think you're going to earn easily right off the bat, 5 to 10 times what you are today, and potentially much more than that. Especially because with AdSense right now, you've just got a few ad placements. I think with those sticky ads that are extremely valuable, those anchored ads in the sidebar and in the footer, you're potentially going to get much more ad time. Now, on the website itself, I do think that there's some design cleanup that needs to be done. Some of these images are full width and some are much smaller. It kind of looks janky, makes it feel very amateur. So I, you know, check in with your theme, figure out why some of these images look different than the others. But overall, you're doing a fantastic job of getting traffic. Now we got to monetize that, and I don't think AdSense is going to be the way to go.
If you find that this kind of content is helpful, seeing actual specific results of not just the theoretical teachings, but where the rubber hits the road, go check out Project 24, our course where we not only have tons of courses, but specifically we have a podcast that we do every single week where we're always talking about specific examples and case studies and things that we're learning. In fact, we're about to go record a really cool case study from one of the websites that we built that is 1 week old and is on track to get 45,000 page views this month. Bye.